why is my friend able to deliver higher watts for a far lower heart rate than me? And he mentions he's at about 236 watts at 116 beats per minute, while I'm averaging 160 beats per minute at the same wattage. So the reason that I threw this in here is we get so many questions about heart rate, like so many of them. And we don't address all of them just because it's we've addressed it in a number of different capacities before. But there's a ton of them. Nate, do you want to jump in on something with this?
I just want to say the answer to this to some of you will be like very obvious, but because we get so many questions on this, we wanted to answer it. And maybe too, with what Chad says, you'll learn something, but not everyone who listens to the podcast has the same understanding of this. And it's important to get this on record.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
Yeah. Okay. So I was banking on a little bit of recovery before I launched into another deep dive, but here goes, Eugene. So I think to sum it up, your question is quite simply, why doesn't heart rate consistently correlate with power output? And super short answer in your case is that your friend's probably fitter than you. The problem is that doesn't necessarily translate to faster. Okay, so the short answer, not the super short, is that how your heart rate relates to power not only varies between riders, but it can even vary within the same rider. And this can be explained by things like training adaptation, of course. It can be due to a number of temporary factors that affect heart rate. Think sleep, dehydration, caffeine ingestion, blood donation can have an impact. Fatigue level or level of recovery, call it whichever you like, but it's a long list. So a number of things that impact heart rate might not impact your ability to create power. And it's for this very reason that training strictly by power poses a number of challenges that you probably won't face if you couple heart rate with power data. And ideally, you ask me, you'll lump RPE, or your rating of perceived exertion, into that whole picture and portray a much clearer picture of what's going on with your body. You know, basically combine the objective with the subjective. But that's a little off topic. So what are some of the causes for all these differences and changes in heart rate? And I want to approach this question from the angle of the cardio system, or really systems. So there's the cardiorespiratory and which is sometimes cardiopulmonary. I honestly don't know if there's a difference. And the cardiovascular system. So really the heart, the lungs, the blood vessels, and of course the actual blood in circulation. And these can all explain one rider's heart rate being vastly different from another's. And also how your heart rate can change as you get fitter and faster. So each of these components of your cardio system can undergo training related changes, and we can achieve them in supplemental ways like altitude training or heat training, that sort of thing. But we're going to limit this discussion strictly to the more typical training. So either riding indoors on your trainer or on rollers, or riding outdoors in your usual outdoor environment. So nothing out of the ordinary, nothing like a training camp or an altitude camp or anything like that. So through regular structured training that progresses at a productively challenging rate, rests you on a normal basis, you reassess your capabilities at normal intervals, we can bring about all sorts of changes to the body. And this includes more than just the muscles. You know, we're also seeing adaptive changes in the heart and the lungs and the blood vessels and the blood, as I referred to earlier. So the three, let's call them levels of adaptation that I see as having arguably the greatest impact on heart rate are the size and strength of your left ventricle. And this is one of the four chambers of the heart that pumps oxygenated blood out to the body. So out to the muscles in our context. Secondly is the hemoglobin and the red blood cell content of our blood. So basically just a couple components of the blood that carry oxygen to our aerobically inclined muscles. And finally, the mitochondria. So within each muscle cell where the oxygen is actually utilized to turn over energy, or as I like to describe it, make, break, and remake ATP. So all of these things we can influence with endurance training. So if we take a really simplistic look at this, start with the left ventricle. The heart can pump so much blood, and it's a matter of a couple of the left ventricle's capabilities. First, it's filling capacity, which has to do with its size, and then its ejection fraction, which kind of has to do with the strength, or really how much of the blood inside it can clear out with each contraction. And that word right there, contraction, it tells you we're dealing with muscle. Yes, cardiac muscle in this case, but cardiac muscle can experience hypertrophy. So similar in some ways to how skeletal muscle can increase cross-sectional area of each muscle fiber. But in cardiac tissue, it's more about enlargement of the compartment and then thickening of the actual cardiac wall. So again, kind of a size and strength sort of deal. So now every time your heart beats, pushes out blood. And how much depends on on these two things, and that's referred to your stroke volume. And then when you simply multiply stroke volume times beats per minute, you get your cardiac output. And this is simply the total amount of blood you push into circulation over a minute's time. And if you can push more blood, your heart doesn't have to beat as many times per minute to do the same amount of work or generate the same amount of watts as someone with lower cardiac output, you know, a weaker or a smaller left ventricle or a lower ejection fraction. So quick recap at this point is that the bigger the heart chamber has, or the bigger the heart chamber is, there's more room to stock up on oxygenated blood and the more strength to pump that blood out to the muscles. This requires less heartbeats per minute as you become fitter. This is going to be a recurring theme. So next up is the hemoglobin and the red blood cells. So we're talking about the blood itself now. With more hemoglobin, we can bind more oxygen, and that means greater delivery capacity to the muscle. With more red blood cells, this also means greater O2 delivery to our working muscles. And then when you combine the two, more hemoglobin in more red blood cells, it's pretty easy to see how we're basically setting the stage for greater and greater aerobic work capacity. But also, it's becoming pretty clear how the heart can beat fewer times while still delivering big quantities of oxygen, and in doing so, lowering heart rate at that same power output, the very same power output that used to require more heartbeats because the blood just wasn't bringing as much oxygen as it is now. So to recap that, a combination of changes to your blood, both brought about via endurance training, means more oxygen gets pushed to the muscle and also means less heartbeats are required per minute as you get fitter. And then finally, let's look at the mitochondria. And it's worth mentioning that there are a whole lot of ways, a lot of factors and adaptations we could look at, but I've limited this particular list to just these three heavy hitters. So once all this blood, think left ventricle, and the oxygen it carries, think hemoglobin and red blood cells, makes it to the muscles, it has to be picked up and utilized. And here too, so many things taking place, but we're just gonna skip to where the oxygen actually reaches the inside of each muscle cell. So all this aerobic supply, all this oxygen is now reliant on both the quantity and the function, or the quality really, of your mitochondria. And it's not enough just to have a bunch of, basically weak sauce mitochondria. It's not enough to have a handful of really robust ones either. We need many, and we need them to function really well. We need them to be healthy. And this also is a result of proper training and adequate recovery. A huge part of which is your diet, but that's a whole other enormous discussion. But it can influence all of this. Suffice it to say, effective endurance training brings about more mitochondria that suck up all this freshly delivered oxygen, meaning less oxygen will make the round trip back to the heart because you're utilizing more of it. And so once again, your heart doesn't have to beat as many times as it used to when you were less conditioned. So final recap, this an elevated level of fitness, so via endurance training in our context, can lead to greater mitochondrial density. That's the term you're going to see quite a lot if you read really anything related to endurance training within your muscle fibers. And this translates to better use of the oxygen it receives, meaning once more, heart has to beat fewer times each minute as your endurance capabilities improve. So I'll wrap that up super quick, it's just that three of the many, many possible training adaptations that can explain how heart rates differ across and within endurance athletes are these three things. There are others. And these don't even take into account the wide range of differences in heart rates totally apart from endurance training, having nothing to do with being an athlete.
So I'm going to summarize. As you get more fit, generally at the same wattage, you will have a lower heart rate. But two, when comparing between two different people, it means nothing. Because it's like comparing the revs in a car for like overall what car is going to be faster. You can have totally different engines. And if you look at our group ramp test, this is a great example, especially the last test, maybe not, or two tests ago. Pete and I are pretty similar in power output, but our heart rates wildly different. People are just commenting on how low Pete's heart rate is relative to his power output. And Lance Armstrong famously had a very high power or heart rate output. And you just can't get speed from power or fitness, but relative to yourself, if you raise your FTP by 100 watts, man, your power at that previous FTP is going to have a much lower heart rate than what it does now at your new FTP.
Oh yeah, absolutely. Amber's going to be joining us again here in just a bit. So one way to look at that is that heart rate is one indicator of something that's going on in the body. However, it is not an indicator of like performance, right, Chad? It's not an indicator of fitness or anything else. You can see trends over time and individually check it out, but it's absolutely
individually. Yeah.
Yep. And that's like a hard thing too, even with trends. Like Nate, I'm sure in this whole process of you discovering your limits and going through that whole thing, I'm sure you've seen heart rate trends, and some days it's been up, some days it's probably been down, and some days it's kind of changed. It's really tough to just kind of put a lot of stock into whatever that data means, right?
Yeah. The biggest correlation I find for performance is just how I feel. Like I feel, I kind of like the day, or once you get into a workout, I pretty much know how well it's going to go. And sometimes my heart rate is higher than normal. Sometimes it's lower than normal. But if, you know, if you feel horrible, it's usually going to be a horrible workout. Not all the time, but usually.
Yeah. Chad, you were going to say something?
No, that's, I was just agreeing with Nate's point. I think in all cases, I mean, data is useful in so many ways, but it just always boils back down to how you feel.
It's like go ahead, Nate.
No, go ahead. I was going to change subjects.
I was going to say, being a fan of motocross racing, it's always extremely frustrating because that sport isn't data driven. Doesn't really have any way to like measure performance necessarily, other than you are faster than the other person. So I don't blame them for using heart rate, but they rely on heart rate so much, and we're pretty spoiled having power, because then we can actually see what a person's doing compared to their weight and see so many different things and get some actual, you know, objective data about what they're doing. So many times I'm watching it and somebody's like, oh, I bet his heart rate's at 190, or like they've even had heart rate data and they're like, that person's at 190 and that person's at 160. The person at 190 must be trying so much harder. And it's not the case.
This happens in the Tour de France too. Right.
Oh, yeah.
Or the power that they stream is like 1 second power, and you'll see, it'll be like 500, 200, 100, 500. And you're like, what's going on here?
It's crazy. It's pointless.
Yeah. Exactly. You're not getting much insight from it. Right. And that's so, yeah, it's definitely something to keep an eye on.
If you like this video, make sure you give us a thumbs up.
If you didn't like this video, you can give it a thumbs down, but let us know what you would have done differently in the comments below.
If you want to see more of these videos, make sure you subscribe to our YouTube channel. And if you want to become a faster cyclist, check out trainerroad.com.
Do it.